This is the platform where we are going to introduce you to some of the alumni who have made their mark in the industry. But you need to also know how they did it. You need to know how hard they worked for it, the amount of experimentation, the amount of effort they put into it. It was not always that they succeeded, but they kept on doing it till they became a legend in their own name. So this is a platform where we will be introducing you to good craftsmen, masters of their art, and basically talk to them. This is not going to be much like a question answer thingy or something like that. It's just a chat between two friends where we will go through and understand how they've made their life. So today, the first guest we are bringing in today is Vikram Bawa. He has a long list of awards under his belt. In fact, more than 15 photography awards. Yeah. And he was selected among the 200 best photographers in the world by Roses Archive, which is by itself is quite an achievement. He also has been recognized as the one of the most influential people in the business of photography by Asian Photography. He has more than 300 published covers on various magazines. You name the magazine, he's done it. Vogue, L'Officiel, whatever. And he has in excess of 500 plus client portfolios in his armory. He shot for the biggest brand name designers, brands, whatever, you name it, and he's done it. And we from Shari have recognized some of our hardworking alumni by giving them the Shari Ratna. And I do believe Vikram was one of the first people to get the Shari Ratna from Shari Academy. So I'm going to invite Vikram into the program now. I think he's already there and waiting for me to start giving him, there you go, the big smile of his. That's a smile which always works, irrespective of what the weather is outside. So I'm glad to have you on board, Vikram. It is so nice to see you. We have been going through a rough time because of this COVID and all that nonsense. This, I think, is a nice way of meeting and chatting with our friends.
I agree. And hopefully everybody is safe. And hi, everyone out there who have joined us. You know, and Girish, thanks for having me. Good fun.
It was a pleasure, in fact. And the first moment we thought of this, the first thing we decided is let's start with Vikram because he's got a very interesting stories to tell. And that's what we're going to be talking about today, basically, is what we need from you is to understand. I know as a fact that you did not start your life career with photography. You were doing a lot of different things at the time. And I know the ups and downs that all of us go through in life and all that thing. What I need to understand is that when you stop doing all of that, you could have decided to do so many different things. Why did you decide on photography?
I was unemployed.
Good one.
Anything else? This was madness in me, passion, you want to call it. I was only seeing images in my eye all the time, continuously seeing photos wherever I'm looking. Even today, I'm only thinking if I crop it like this, if I shoot it like this, can I use it like this, you know? So it's like a 24/7, the mind was working. It was not like that till the age of, I'd say 17, I actually didn't discover photography too much in the sense like my mom and dad were very good avid self-portrait artists, you know, brilliant at their work and something even I have not been able to touch in the way they shot themselves. And I'm talking in those days, which is film, not digital. So, which is like hats off to the way they did it. And what happened was I picked up a camera was fascinated, but when I shot with it, you know, film in those days, I was not good at it. I mean, every frame of mine came black, blurred, you know, blank, whatever. I sold the camera. That was when I was 15. And at 17, I picked up the same camera again, and I was like, yeah, you know, try my thing. Let's try this thing. So I, studied the manual, studied the camera, went out and shot some pictures, and I was hooked. That was it. Like, you know, and I wanted to shoot all the time. And took a while because I was in college. I did photography in college. In fact, now when I look back, I in fact shot for money for a couple of small brands, you know, in college itself. But during my college days, I started a chemical company and got lost on the way over there. Did that for 7-8 years. But photography, you know, had become like a germ in me. It was just all getting bigger and bigger and bigger. So when there was an opportunity to, you know, get out of what I was doing, that was the only thing I knew. See, I was a maths graduate, but you don't get jobs for maths graduates unless you're going into a higher studies or something. Law student, never completed it, so couldn't become a lawyer. Tried and failed businessman. So I didn't want to do anything of that sort, nor did I have the, you know, bandwidth to go there again. So photography is something that I loved, and my father had seen me, you know, get fascinated with it and go crazy about it. And he said, why don't you just do that? I mean, you love it and you always wanted to do it. So I just jumped at the chance and I got into it, unaware of the market, unaware of people, what I'm going to do, you know, who I'm going to meet. But God was kind, and it was a journey, and, you know, still a journey. I think I feel I've done only maybe 5 or 10% of what is in my mind or what I want to achieve in photography. So I'm still learning.
Well, that is true. I mean, you never stop learning. Even me, after having taught for so long, I mean, you've been in the photography industry for 40 years now, I still learn. And especially now with the digital and the kind of new stuff that's coming in, why not? I mean, there's so much more to learn. Anyway, so how did you, hobby photography, or even a little bit more like more serious than hobby photography, and then going into commercial photography, which has a lot of parameters which you need to take care before you can really get into the kind of money-making business. So how did you prepare yourself to get into that level?
Okay, so the thing is, I see a lot of young kids coming up and they want to be photographers. They have a camera and they think it's a digital, so you see what you're shooting. And some of them are really good at their work, you know, touch wood, which is great. But they think, you know, just because they have a camera and just because they're good at their work, that they will survive and, you know, they will make it. It's not that easy. What happened was, I got lucky in the sense that I had run a small company as a CEO, you know, and I had actually started the company from scratch. So I had worked as a carpenter, electrician, you name it, till, you know, I was heading the company. It was like a startup. So I knew what goes into making a business. I knew that you need an X type of, hard work, systems, follow throughs, you know, so there are levels of, ideation, if you want to call it, of planning, production, sales, marketing, and billing. A lot of kids don't know how to bill. They'll just say, "Haan, hamara charge itna hai." They don't understand what goes into usage right, copyrights, you know, your shooting rates, your digital capture charges. So I was a little lucky in the sense that when I started out, I did a lot of research, and I've always been one of those guys. I do a lot of research. Like, I pick up things very fast. I mean, you give me something to read, and by the time you're on the second page or third page, I'll be on the 10th page, because I sort of have that, aptitude to grasp information very fast. So I realized on the day one, on first day, my first shoot, that I need to have a system in place where I have a proper invoice so that it's easier for everyone involved, the client, for me. There are no issues. I realized on day one that there is something called copyright, there is usage right. Because see, I was a hobbyist for 8 years while I was doing this, you know, other business. So as a hobbyist, I had the time to read. And like, so I read and I read and I read. And I tried to understand how, you know, internationally photographers work. Because in India, we didn't have that much. You know, this is before internet or just when internet was starting out. You know, basically, I became a hobbyist before internet, right? So there was no way you could, you know, even interact with someone like a Girish. Like, I didn't know about you. How do I know about you? Because there's no internet to type in best photography schools in India. So everything was word of mouth. You know, everything was walking on the streets and finding. I found PSI, Photography Society of India in VT. That too, because my dad's office was close by. So one of his people said, there's a photography guy hai, so why don't you go there? So I joined over there. I understood how people work. So I interacted and I read and I studied a lot. And I think that 8 years was my schooling where I learned composition out there. I learned lighting. I learned experimenting. I learned physical masking, cutting, pasting of photos before Photoshop, you know, actually cutting photos together, creating layers, shooting it so that there's a depth. You know, Girish, you've done all those things, you know. So that was like my 8 years of training, if you want to call it. So when I started out, I had a business, not exactly a business plan, but I had a business plan. I knew that I need a folio. I knew that I need to have some pictures, nice pictures, 8 or 10 pictures. I knew what I liked. So I put that in my portfolio. Of course, I wasn't perfect because even at that time when I would go up to show my work to people, they would be like, why are you trying so many things? And, you know, and I didn't understand that because a lot of young photographers will shoot cars, you know, they'll shoot sceneries and they'll shoot models and then they'll make a folio and go to an agency to show their work. And the agency will be like, but what is it that you actually do? You know, which is sadly something I don't agree with. But yes, everybody should have a specialization. So as it turned out, my specialization ended up being fashion because I was exposed to it through my college. I was exposed to it through my mom, who used to have a small design boutique. And landscapes, because when I was working, I was traveling 8 hours a day, you know, so my 8 hours travel was my photography class, if you want to call it 3.5-4 hours in the morning, 3.5-4 hours in the evening. So I was only looking to find pictures on that journey. So I made a plan and as luck would have it, my first day of my studio, I had a shoot. The third day of my studio, I had a shoot. After that, for 6 months, I had no work. Actually, no work, zero work.
Yeah, that's like history for us.
Yeah, that's how it was. And I was like, you know, when you get a shoot on the first day, it was a great shoot. I shot with some a Miss India in those days, you know, and a very good model. And I guided them, in fact, on how to promote themselves. Because like I said, you know, I had learned along the way that promotion, marketing, sales is very important. So you need to go out there and put it. So I guided them on how to do it for themselves. As luck would have it, while they were doing the marketing, my marketing was also happening with them, you know, because as the photographs were being put up and stuff. So my journey started, but yeah, then for 6 months, I only experimented because I'd never shot in a studio, to be very frank. So I had shot means a couple of times at PSI just to experiment, or, you know, hire the studio for, why I think in those days, 100 rupees and 200 rupees.
That's right. It was very cheap. In fact, the start point for a lot of photographers.
Yeah. So PSI had a small studio for 100 rupees for 4 hours, 200 for 8 hours, something like that. And in those days, 100 rupees was also a lot. I mean, if you look at it today, I know, calculate, multiplied by 100, I would say. Like, so I had done a little bit, but I had done studio lights with ambient setting because I didn't know how to use a flash, you know. So in my studio, you know, I did my first shoot with studio lights without knowing anything about photography. Or, I mean, I had, you can say, book knowledge on using studio lights. And I did my first shoot. I did my second shoot. It turned out well. I got the little confidence. And then I experimented with my friends for 6 months, like, you know, trying different lighting, designing a course for myself, and sort of trying to see how I could reach out and start working with the right people. So yeah, I mean, it's a journey till there at least.
Yeah, because I find it very interesting. So the first time you came to me, I don't know how you found me, but the first time you came to me, and at that point of time, we were not even talking about education. I think at that point of time, we were talking about your work and stuff like that. And then I was saying that, Baba, tere kaam to acha hai, you're doing a pretty decent job. And then out of the blue, you said, but I want to do your workshop. And then you enrolled for a workshop. You know, and that's the first time that I had somebody who's already in the business and then come for education. Normally, you have people come for the education, then go for the business, you know.
I think that is one thing I've realized now after 25 years is a positive in me that I want to challenge myself. I want to test myself. I want to see where I stand, you know, today or every day. So when I came to you, I was already a professional for I think 2, 3 years. Okay. And I had already done quite a few shoots. I was working with some agencies. I had already had 2 or 3 small exhibitions. In fact, I was invited for those exhibitions. I had articles in the papers by that time about my work. I don't know if you remember the Baba effect or the red effect, they used to call it, infrared photography.
That's
So
correct.
what happened was, you may not remember that I had met you at a small lecture you gave, I think at KC College or somewhere, on photography. So you had given a lecture at KC College when I was a hobbyist. That was almost 7 years or something before I came for your workshop, somewhere around maybe 93, 94.
I think that was organized by Sumit Chopra, if I'm not wrong.
So Sumit, yes, Sumit did a workshop at Parsi Sanitarium
That's right.
and then a talk at KC College. That was 93. And in 93, I have met a lot of you people. Like, I met Sumit, I met Ashok, I met you, and like, if you remember Sumit, he was one of these fun guys, always giving. He cared a damn who comes in, doesn't get in, very secure about himself, and he was very ready to teach, which I liked. And then amongst the others, I found you very willing to share knowledge. And so I sort of, I think, remembered that. So when I got sucked into photography, it was very sudden. It was not like a gentle transition. One day I was working, second day I was unemployed, so third day I had to get into photography because I needed to do something with my life. So when you're 26, 27, you can't just sit and say, "Acha, I didn't have the money to just sit and enjoy. I needed to do something." So I got sucked into photography, and I did that for 2 years and 3 years, and then I read about your workshop. I don't remember how or where, who told me. And I ended up coming to your space, and you didn't remember maybe, but I remembered you. So I came and I wanted to see how, you know, see, the thing is, I was an untrained photographer. So I needed to understand what I was doing, I was on the right track or not. And I attended your workshop for 2 days, I think, you know.
No, 6 days.
What? No, no. 6 days? No, I think 2 and 4 hoga baad mein. Something like that. I don't remember exactly.
Was 3 days of people and 3 days of still life or something like that.
Maybe, maybe.
So that's how I started in those days.
So the thing is, when I came to you, I was already doing work. I was already experimenting. I was already being seen, shown, whatever. But coming to your workshop, I started seeing light. I always say that. Like, if you remember, you had this thing where you used to light up an apple or a ball, you
That's
know,
correct.
and you used to show the lighting. So I was doing photography in the studio. I had till then shot almost like maybe 50 or more small ad campaigns when I came to you. But I had done it blind in the sense I was doing it from feel. I was doing it from what I felt looked good. And maybe I'm a natural when it comes to seeing light, and I didn't realize it. But when I came to you, I actually started seeing light. And when I mean today, I can physically see light, whether it is flash when I pop it, I can see where it is fallen before it comes on my camera, you know, before I see the picture. And a lot of times I'm shooting without looking at my viewfinder or my screen, because I know what's coming is what I wanted, or I stop that I know it's not coming. And that I will say I learned from you, because I came there, you were very willing to teach lighting to everyone, show how it is, how to see the angles, how to see the shadows, how one item can be lit up in so many ways. And I think that first 15 minutes was paisa vasool for the next 6 days.
Well, I'm glad because I brought you into our sphere. And I have been watching your, I would like to use the word tryst with destiny. Yeah. Because you've been doing so many crazy things in life.
Yeah.
And I remember that, you know, the early struggle that you made when there was a lot of competition was not really that nice, also for that matter. But I'm not getting into that part of it. But the question is that what I liked about it is that you fought it. You fought it with work. You fought it with the kind of experimentation that those people had never done, you know. So I want the people to know that it's not so easy to become a Vikram Bawa today. You know, in the sense that you have a camera, two, three video picture, dekha, aur to koi lagta you become, I am going to compete with our friend here. But they need to understand how heavily you struggled right through the stuff. So I want them to understand the amount of experimentations and stuff that you've done. And if I remember right, the first experimentation you did was what, 3D or the infrared?
Infrared.
It started with infrared. No, I'm going to ask you about, you know, to talk about infrared, your experiment, your experience with it. And you have the images on? Do you have the images on? Do you want to show them some images before you?
So
you get an idea what it is, infrared or 3D, whichever.
Infrared.
We're going to talk about both. I want them to understand in those days, in fact, 3D won you an award.
Yes, 3D won me an award through your school, in fact. Yeah, and
first PAE award, I think.
Yeah, it was the first one. I don't know if you know, the pictures went around to 30 countries.
That's correct.
Yeah.
So basically, you took my school's name to 30 countries.
Well, okay, now you need to pay me. Yeah. No, so yeah, we got lucky maybe because no one had done 3D in those days on a fashion or a commercial level. So, I think we just got lucky. So my infrared, see, I guess when I got into photography, I was, you can say unbiased in terms of the style or the type of photography that I wanted to do or I was doing, because you know, like a lot of time people get stuck on one thing, whereas since I was still learning and I'm still learning, I kept experimenting with different things and I wanted to keep experimenting with different things. I didn't want to
stop. I can't see your images though.
I don't know, 1 second, something's yeah. Images are not loading up. Okay. Just a sec.
But the net is also going haywire. I think something is that. These are not infrared, I think.
No. I'm trying to reach the pictures. It's just that the net is a little slow. I think because we are also on Zoom and stuff like that. So hold on 1 second. I will have them in a different space. Also, hopefully. Give us a second.
So those were very interesting pictures which you did, Daniel.
Yeah.
We played with the colors.
Yes.
Background and color, both are lovely.
This is the color series.
Yeah, you were using the foliage and greenery and then changing colors, yeah. And so beautifully balanced.
Yeah, so the thing is that I started out like a landscape photographer, got into fashion. So somehow most of my work, I still see it as a landscape photo. I always, even if I'm shooting fashion, for me, it's still a landscape with a person in the landscape, you know. So it's like, and I need to balance both of them if possible. So these are like the color landscape pictures. I mean the color infrared pictures.
ये infrared नहीं है, ये आपका fashion का sequence है, I think.
No. This is infrared cross
processed.
Yeah, so I used to shoot infrared and then cross-process them.
Too. Yeah, that's what I wanted people to understand, because I don't think any one of these guys know what cross-processing is, or for that matter, what black and red infrared or color infrared. Yeah, I don't know. Which is why I thought if you could share some stuff, which is, my God, look at this. It actually looks like normal stuff.
Yeah, so the thing is, it's all about capturing light, you know, and I don't think I have the black and white infrared. I just have the color.
Doesn't matter. Get an idea. They're of course most welcome to visit your website and check it out. Basically,
yeah, they can. I mean, our website is also getting revamped, so it'll take a while for that, but it's fine. Like, you know,
that's not an issue. Yeah. So at that particular point of time, how did you source those films? How did you process those films? How rough was it to get all that thing organized?
So the thing is, infrared film was generally used, you know, for medical and technical aspect, you know, applications. It was never meant for people photography. It was meant more for capturing heat signatures and, you know, areas where they were
doing photography, security.
Those type of things. And I read an article, like I said, I used to read a lot. I read an article about the effect of, you know, final effect of the pictures after shooting the landscape. So I started shooting the landscapes first. And I was already shooting landscapes in infrared, I think, before I became a professional. It was a hobby. So when I became a professional, automatically I tried putting it in the fashion sense. And when I put it in the fashion space, is when I said, okay, fine, like this is how. So I think it took me a year of experimenting, traveling, shooting sceneries, landscapes, trying to understand how we can make it look good. Like, you know, and what is the right filter to use to get the different effects. So, like I said, maybe it's the match graduation, the analytical step-by-step calculations. So what I did was I took my camera, I put the film in, and I would put every possible colored filter and take a photo and write down, this is what I've shot on frame number one, frame number two, mix the filters, frame number five, seven, whatever. Come back, and you know that we had to come back, finish 36 frames, process the roll. So sometimes it would take me 1 week, 2 weeks. So that's why I got the habit of noting down what I'm doing, so that when I look at the pictures, I know what's happened over there, you know. And I think it took a lot of experimentation, almost a year or so, till I got it right with models in the infrared space, you know. And without the models, I already knew what could be done. So I experimented, I showed my work to people, and some magazines loved it. So I got 2 shoots from a magazine for my infrared fashion show, shoot. And they said, yeah, why not? Let's do this. And I mean, it just worked, sort of.
Ray has found some black and whites of yours. Would you like us to show it to them?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Yes, that is infrared. That's infrared. Yeah.
Of series, which I think was Bernard, which.
This is
the Jindal Sunita, right? Sangeeta Jindal, what was her name?
Yeah. So this is a collection, my art collection, which is a part of the Jindal art collection.
That's right.
So I'm one of the few, if not one of the only photographers who shows also with artists. Like, you know, when artists, I mean sculptors, you know, painters and stuff like that. And this was commissioned by the Jindals for part of the collection.
Yeah, that was a lovely exhibition, because I was there when it was exhibited.
Yeah. So I mean, it was a very surreal shoot, because I actually was not going to shoot this on infrared. I was shooting it on digital, but my digital packed up after like the first few frames, and I was stuck. So I had only infrared film with me. And I decided to shoot with that and just keep shooting with that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I was wondering how people accepted the results for fashion, because at that time there was this obsession of everything being very clean kind of stuff. But
a couple of magazines who picked it up. In fact, Elle also wanted to use my pictures, you know, the ones I had shot. And so, yeah, but I didn't experiment too long with it in the sense like, I think it's my nature. When I start experimenting, I start creating, then I push it, I take it forward. And then after a while, I move on to other things. So that's the way my nature is. So I moved on to 3D, you know, and I experimented with 3D photography. And that
I remember that time because you used to come and pick my brains on that also.
Yeah. So, so 3D photography in the days of film was not very easy. I mean, it's still not that easy, but still easier in a way. It took me 2 years to get the hang of, getting it right all the time. So, I mean, that was a journey where every morning I would come to the studio. I would, you remember Polaroids and how expensive Polaroids were.
Yeah.
So first I started shooting 3D on Polaroid. Okay. And, but it wasn't giving me the results I wanted. So then I started shooting on film. So on film, I would come every morning. I would shoot some frames. I would cut the film, take it for processing, see what's happened, come back next day. And I did that actually for 700 days till I got it right.
That is exactly what is missing right now, Vikram. This was exactly what we were feeling, that the current genre of photographers are not interested in experimenting or really going in depth and learning. In fact, you will be surprised that in a school also like ours, you'll have students who will not come for all the lectures, and you ask them the question, okay, how come you didn't come for this lecture? He says, okay, I would only come for a proper class. Now I'm wondering what the proper class would be. But that guy has already mentally made up his mind. You know, and he does not want to expand his horizons. Anyway, we showed some of your 3D pictures, but it's not much fun unless you give them the glasses.
You need the glasses to see the pictures.
But at least I know one thing, that our track record at the PIEA, which is the one of the biggest photography school versus photography school competition that happens in the world. It used to happen in the world. Now the PMA shut down because Kodak, Betak, everybody shut practically on. You know. So I remember that you were the one who got us the first award from PIEA with your 3D pictures. You started the ball rolling, and then the students worked hard, and you won't believe it, but you got 5 grand awards from that place.
Wow.
Finally.
Yeah, I remember you getting the couple of them. I didn't know it's become 5 now. Yeah.
It's five of them. And the funny part of yours, if I want to remember what happened on the, I was on the way to a Mazda party, which was, I think, held at the US club, you know. And in the car, I found out that on the way that we had won the PIEA and it was your picture that we won. You can't believe the party I had that night. It was Mazda party, but it became my party. We were so happy with that first thing that came in. Okay, now here, I also want to bring in something, because a lot of people today are overly dependent on Instagram and Facebook and whatever social media they have for marketing themselves and all the thing. Personally, I feel that yes, those are good tools, of course, but at the same time, what happens is you do get lost in that plethora of people trying to get in.
Yeah.
And also, even if you email your work to editors and stuff like that, but those guys must be getting 100 emails a day. I don't even know how many times they would be even opening up those emails and stuff. Like
that. Yes, I know what you mean.
What I remember is that you, very early, in fact, one of the first guys who went into analog market, and you went into analog marketing in a big way. I think you were the first guys who started sending your personalized calendars and posters and postcards and whatnot you used to do with that.
So,
but I think that was beautiful. Can you give us your experience on that?
Yeah, so what happened was, when I started out, I realized if I want to show my work to someone, I could get a meeting after a few calls, go there, show them a folio. And remember, this is not, laptops, it's film. So we had prints mounted nicely, carrying a 10 kilo bag, walking to a place, you know, to an agency, then putting out your folio, showing the pictures one by one. I still prefer that my method rather than showing on a laptop. It's still more personal. People start picking up and they want to ask you, what you. So even today, if I have to show my work, I still show prints. I don't show digitally. If I can avoid it, yes, I avoid it. Of course, if you're emailing, you can't avoid it. So I realized that one of the biggest agencies to show my work. And the gentleman is sitting there and he looks at my work and he says, I've seen this work somewhere. And I had actually shot a calendar for a client and that calendar was sitting behind him on the table. And he didn't remember me. You get it? So I realized that these people meet so many people that he likes my work. He'll give me work today if he has work. But if he doesn't have work on the spot, he's going to forget me after 15 days. So I needed to find a way to market. And I realized the only way to market is, you know, continuously keep sending something. A few people were doing calendars, a yearly calendar, and one or two people. But I realized that calendar also, after a while, it's just sitting on the desk. You don't remember the photographer. So I started sending out monthly posters. So every month I would send a poster, an A4 size poster, or rather at that time it was an A3 size poster. Later it became A4 because I increased the frequency. First it was a bi-monthly, A3 size, then it became monthly. So I made it A4 for the cost factor. And I realized I could send them at least 12 different type of pictures or different type of things to show to them. And that's what helped me make a brand name, that constant marketing going on for years. So yeah, it was a journey to do that. It wasn't easy to keep telling people who I am. It's not easy to keep walking. Even today, it's not going to be easy to walk to 300 production houses in Bombay or maybe another 50 agencies and get meetings and show your work. So that was one way I realized, yes, it's a little money spent, but it was necessary for me.
So it worked for you, basically. It really worked.
See, marketing of any type works. Whether today it's Instagram marketing, if you can tap it well, if you can push it well, great. You know, if it's online on your website, it's great. For me, the physical form factor still holds dear. That is what I want to do.
Yeah, because you see, what happens is that most of the current generation, they are used to seeing the picture backlit.
Yeah.
Because when they shoot it, they see it on their viewfinder, the screen. Then they see it on their computer, everything. Yeah. You know, on your Instagram, whatever. But to see a physical print, which is front lit, there is a lot of difference, especially because in the printing versus backlit, there's a lot of difference in how it is. When you present a good print, the client also gets better impressed, actually.
Yeah.
So I think it makes sense. Yeah, you see. Okay, I was expecting this. It was for Vikram sir to get into the market, Bahadi. How tough it was for Vikram sir to get into the market?
Very tough. I mean, looking back, quite interesting. So the first time I went to an agency to show my work, a lot of agencies in those days had coordinators in-house or one person who would deal with the photographer. Today you have creative directors, national creative directors, art directors, and still there are some photo buyers or photo editors in some agencies. So this gentleman takes me to his cabin and he asked me to show him my work. So I have not reached the creative people. He is the bodyguard, if you want to call it, or a security man who's going to see my work and then decide if I'm good enough to go ahead.
Correct. Okay.
So he takes me to this cabin. Before I can open my desk, there is a list with the name of the top photographers of the country and their rate. So I already now know, okay, he works with these 15 people. These are the rates of these people. So I suddenly understand what my stature is going to be, even if he likes my work. And what is the rate that I can charge? Even if I want to charge more, I can't because I am still a new guy. So I showed him my work over there and I came back and he calls me up and he says, I have a Coca-Cola campaign. Would you be interested in doing that? I was very excited. He's like, it's for 2 days and I will pay you so much. I said, but my rate is this much, you know, so what you're offering me is less. He's like, yeah, but you don't have to do anything. I said, matlab, it's a Coca-Cola campaign. What do you mean by I don't have to do anything? And believe it or not, he didn't give me a photography assignment. He gave me a modeling assignment. So
That's a good one. Yeah. I should find that ad.
And I, you know, and if you know me, I wear these red shoes all the time at one point. So I was wearing a red shirt, red shoes, pajamas in the middle, you know, a red turban. So I look Coca-Cola, like, you know, and he gave me a modeling assignment. I worked with him. We became friends, but he didn't give me a job. He didn't give me any photography job. I went around meeting other agencies for, I think, almost a year, maybe, before one agency finally said, I have a shoot, I'll give it to you. It was an LIC shoot. And LIC used to be a big client in those days. I don't know if you remember. They were the few guys who used to actually do photo shoots. It was a very interesting shoot because I had to run around to Crawford Market, a store, a banya, convince him on the spot to let me shoot him. We're not paying him, you know. And we shot, I think, around 8 or 10 people. We would go to them, sir, hum LIC se aaye hain, and we want to do a photo shoot. Aapke paas LIC policy hai? And 90% people had an LIC policy, you know. So you'd be like, "Haan, toh sir, hum aapka photo dalenge ki aapke paas LIC ka policy." So most people got excited. We ended up shooting the whole day. It was almost a 20-hour shoot because we shot in store. Then we needed to shoot in offices. So we had to randomly pick up people and convince them to come to the agency office and shoot in the agency office itself. So every place I went was not an ideal place. There was no space to do lighting. There was, and shooting on a medium format, you need a little depth, you know, to make it look interesting. Or you use a wide angle, still looks interesting, but your lighting needs to be perfect. So, you know, so I did that shoot. And in fact, sorry, this is not my first shoot, but anyway, let me finish this. So that was one, that was the interesting shoot. The client loved the pictures. And I started getting a little bit more work. My first shoot, actually, a proper advertising job, was shooting Surf ka packet and a sugar ka box. Now I remember, for Lintas. So that was my first advertising shoot where I went and I showed my fashion work. And they gave me a Surf ka packet, and they gave me a free gift with the Surf packet, which was a sugar box filled with sugar. And I had to shoot it, you know, and I went crazy trying to get the lighting right. And after spending 4 hours, the art director says, why are you doing so much lighting? I said, you're showing me a layout. You want it like this, right? So the lighting has to match. No, we want it separately. I said, but you never told me. I'm trying to match lighting on a sugar ka dabba and a sugar, you know, a transparent sugar box and a Surf ka box. Spend my 4 hours, you know. But anyway, that was my first experience at advertising. And from there, you know, small jobs, big jobs, Maruti, standard Furukawa battery range, you know. So I did everything. Coca-Cola, Maruti, standard Furukawa, Atta. I shot an Atta ka chakki actually in my studio. Those were the advertising jobs that I was getting. I was still showing my work. So after almost, I think, 2 years, I walked into a big agency, HTA, which is JWT today. And they saw my work. One of the creative directors saw my work. And he loved my work. And when I told him my rate, he looked at me. He's like, you're mad. I said, why, sir? He's like, you should be putting, you know, I was charging. So let me put it out there. I was charging 7,000 a day in those days. And he said, you should be charging 17,000. I was like, what? 17,000? I got scared that if I say 17,000, I won't get work. Am I hearing right? He said, no, you're worth 17,000, not 7,000. That is when I realized that my work is good. It's decent. And I started going out with a little more confidence. So I think it's very important also to meet the right people. People who will tell you genuinely on your face whether you're good or bad. If you're bad, you need to go back and see, are you really bad, and try and change or improve rather. Not change, improve on your work. So, you know, and it went on like that. And I don't think I actually started making money for the first 4 years or something like that. I struggled. The first year, I made 12,000 rupees, let's say profit of 8,000 rupees, my first shoot. And I survived on that for 6 months. You know, no work. I have to pay salary to my assistant. my studio, which I was lucky that, you know, it belonged to my, you know, you can say my mom and her friends, and they let me use a part of their space as a studio in those days. So I didn't have to pay a rent, but I had to take out every other cost of my working. So yeah, I think it's, the journey is not changed. Only the scale may have changed. The, you know, value of my work may have changed. My, you know, the zero may have changed, but the hard work that I was doing then is the same I'm doing now. The marketing that I was doing then is the same I'm doing now. So there is no difference. It's a constant 25 years of marketing myself to get the next job, because you are a freelancer and you're only as good as your last job. So if your last job is very good, you will get the next few jobs. You make one mistake and you know it, they will write you off in 1 second and they will stop working with you. So it's a constant journey, constant coming up with ideas on how to promote yourself, constantly trying to show your work, constantly experimenting that, you know, what you're doing, constantly making processes in your office like a business on how to handle situations. You know, Girish, shall I talk about running a studio and running the business, or do you want to touch on that later?
Yeah, we can actually, because funnily, everybody knows you as a fashion, but you've done cars and architecture and everything. So, yeah. But do you want to do that later, or do you want to do it now?
We can show the work if you want to do that.
We can show the work, but before we show the work, now you see, you, one of the things that is definitely coming across, Vikram, from your talk today, is that there was a lot of hard work, there's a lot of struggle that you put in, 25 years of slogging that you've done it.
Yeah.
No, not all, most people see is the last bit.
Yeah.
And they, oh, this right up there and all that kind of stuff, you know. It's like me, the real Girish Mishti ka naam hai, Shari Academy ka naam hai, malum hai 40 years laga, you know, and you're still struggling, like you said. Yeah. You're still working hard and on the whole thing. But the question here is, there comes a moment in life, chota moments.
Yeah.
And I remember once when you shared that little moment with me, and I would like to see if we can share it with your with the people here. And that moment was, how did you feel and how did your father and mother feel, you know, when you walked into a Skoda showroom and picked up a Skoda convertible and took them sports for a long time?
Skoda Sports.
Yeah. It was a very expensive car, but you just went in and said, give it a car, I want it now, if I remember right.
Yeah.
Or how did your parents feel about it? How did you feel about it?
So, you know, the thing is that I've always been a car buff. You know, I love driving. I've driven around the country. You know, I've co-hosted car shows at one point. So, you know, I was looking for a car. I didn't have money. I mean, even though I was a photographer now for, I think, almost 8 years or something, I didn't have the money personally to buy a car, a proper big, nice car. But I had the confidence ki kaam aa raha hai. So I went to a showroom and I saw this car, and I didn't like any cars out there because I'm a race freak, if you want to call it. I like speed. So when I went to Skoda, I saw the car, I drove it, and I told them, this is crap. You know, what is this? I mean, you're charging so much and you're giving me a crappy car. So they said, sir, we have a race model, which not too many people know about, and we don't sell it. We have a demo, which we use as a, you know, transport vehicle, because no one buys it. It's expensive in those days and no one wants to drive so fast. So average is very less. And I remember going there and trying the demo car. I fell in love with it. They came to my office to see my papers and they said, sir, you don't have the money to buy this car. And I said, you know, you don't bother about that. You give me the car and the loan and I'll do it. I'll take care of the thing. So the way you're remembering the story is a little different. I bought the car and I think all of us were excited that I bought the car. And that was the first car with my own money. In fact, I didn't have money to pay down payment. And my best friend, and he and me went around to all the ATMs taking out 500,000 rupees from the 10 credit cards we had. and to pay a 30,000 rupees down payment, and we got 15. So my friend always says 1% of the car belongs to him because he never took the money back from me. And I mean, that was a struggle that to make money to even get that car. And the struggle was more when I wanted to buy my parents a car. That's the actual story. The first car I somehow managed, you know, loan and all. The struggle started when I wanted to buy my parents a car and I actually had zero balance in my bank. And my father almost got a heart attack when I gave him the car. Like, he was like, go give it back. I said, Dad, you can't do that. He's like, who's going to pay for it? I said, you don't worry about it. But I think I just had the confidence that, yeah, I'll work harder. And I did work harder. I just knew that I have to take out the money. So I slogged more. I used to sleep at 4:35 in the morning, you know, working on pictures, experimenting, you know, at that time, digital had just come out, touching up and stuff like that. I used to come back at work at 9 in the morning, 9, 9:30, because I only opened. So I used to sleep and I've always had a habit of sleeping less. So 4 hours was my, you know, sleep time and everything else was only about work, work, work. The day went in either shooting or marketing myself and meeting people, showing them work or just trying to meet people. The nights went in the retouching. So I think that's like a huge part of my journey.
Okay. If you want to start showing some pictures, so what do you want to start with?
Well, yeah, we can show them like, you know, some of the tougher work that we did and how we did it.
Sure. Tougher ones.
Yeah, let her show that. She's got it. So let her show the Skoda campaign. Yeah. So also, I think the viewers should understand that, you know, it's not always that you have to wait for a job to come to you. You can actually walk up to a client with a concept and show it to them and say, I have this concept. Would you be interested? You know, whether you know the client or not, but you can always try and reach out. So you should always try and reach out with a concept, a campaign, an idea and show it to them and say, this is what I want to do. Like, you know, and would you be interested? And 1 out of 10 will at least appreciate it and maybe like pick it up.
You're just playing the movie.
This is the black and white the Skoda campaign. Do we have the pictures here or?
Yeah, I have.
So you know, while this is going on, I'll just tell you that this shoot actually started at 2:30 in the afternoon. We finished the next morning at 6:30. By 9:30, I had gone home, showered and come back to the studio and started downloading the pictures and working on the pictures. And 4 in the morning, the next morning, the pictures were given and 5:30, the pictures were put up at this exhibition for which Skoda was happening for the launch of their car. So technically we worked, I guess, almost 36 hours or 30 hours or whatever, you know, let's say 2:30, 2:30, whatever. Yeah. So something like 24 to 30 hours nonstop without sleep. My whole team, every one of us from start to finish, pictures going up. This is the picture. If you can pause it over there.
We'll show the pictures. Instead of the blurred pictures, we'll show them the pictures.
Yeah. So you know, the whole, so the, you know, since I'd bought that car by chance, Skoda knew that I love, you know, driving these fast cars and they knew I'm a photographer. And I had actually given them an idea before this and done a shoot with them, you know. And so they came back to me for the launch and they said, can you come up with something for us? So I came up with these ideas. Now, trust me, there is only 10 to 20% of Photoshop in this. This is 90% or rather more actually one shot. We have lit up the whole mill with lighting, which started at 2:30 in the afternoon. Lighting gets over at around 10:30 in the night. This is the first shot, which you have right on right now. At 11:30, we are during the rainy season, we are shooting. It is July, I still remember. We're shooting at that point. And the car is in the air, not with Photoshop. It is not Photoshop. It is actually put up on jacks, different height of the jacks, which we have put over there in such a way that, you know, the car looks like it's flying. I'm lying on the floor. In the video, it's there. I'm lying on the floor It's raining out there, and it was a one take. It was a one take. The only thing I removed was the jacks from below in Photoshop, because we had no time. We had to finish the shoot, retouch the pictures, and give it to them. In this shot, this is a two take. This is one take for the car and one take for the model. That's it. There is nothing else. I'm almost 100 foot high, tied to a crane, actually physically tied to a crane. My camera is tied to a crane. So, you know, hopefully I don't fall down. And we made a, you know, a mud trough or a mud path for the car to go. We got a Skoda driver. You know, these drivers who drive in their garages are very good because they have to move in small spaces.
That's right.
We got one of the best drivers from the garage. We told him, you have to go here and your pani splash hona chahiye. And this is actually, I think in the video, it's maybe there, or I have the raw file, where it's just a one take of the splash going up. There is no Photoshop in that. The lighting took me time. And when I was doing this lighting, all the lighting guys were telling me, sir, what is this car ko aise kon lighting karta hai? I said, you don't worry. Just let me do my lighting. Like, you know, because no one had actually lit up a car, because, you know, generally cars are lit up clean. So I did the lighting, very simple lighting. It's one light on one. I mean, not one light, of course, a bank of lights on one side through, you know, your gateway paper on the other side. If you see the dicky, there's a, you know, on the back of the dicky, there's a line. So that's like a highlight, which is a direct light. In the front, there's a soft light. Of course, the model was shot in the same place. Once the car passed away, then we got the model. And I didn't take too many shots. I took 3 frames because we couldn't make that mud thing again and again. So I had to be accurate. So, you know, so the first shot was the shot which worked for us. I mean, this was my first shoot where I actually worked 24 hours nonstop.
It's Mukesh Mills, right?
This is Mukesh Mills.
You can recognize that place anyway.
Yeah. This is Mukesh Mills. And she's actually on one of those cranes hanging with a vest inside, you know, in the movie. You have it in the movies. And the girl is screaming because it's very painful. When you wear that and when you're pulled up, if it's not tied properly, it's very painful. And I realized that women have a different vest and men have a different vest. But in India, you don't have a vest for women. Now, of course, you must be, but this is a while back. So
true. That would have hurt, basically.
So this is like 4 shots done from 11:30 in the night till 6 in the morning, 6:37 in the morning, because we were shooting in the night. I didn't want daylight at all. I wanted to light the car like a studio shot, like, you know, but in an outdoor space. And everything is lit up. Everything is shot over there in one shot almost. And the maximum Photoshop we've done is taken away kachra, taken away the wire, which is behind this girl, cleaned up the car a little bit, and it's gone to print because we didn't have the time to do too much.
Yeah. But it's an interesting shot. It also shows how much effort goes in behind each shot. It's not something that, like, today they just shoot it and say, "Baad mein kar lenge," and I'm wondering, what are they talking about?
Yeah, so if you remember, I had come to your college also and I had got upset once. Okay, Photoshop is the last resort, guys, because I'll give you all an example. There was a time before COVID and when the market was a little better, I was shooting 15 days to 20 days a month. Now, please understand, I'm shooting 1,000 frames a day on a campaign in digital.
Correct.
I'm shooting 15 days, let's assume. Basically, I'm shooting on a Monday. On a Tuesday, I have to do the backup, color correction, you know, renaming, tagging, low res, send to client, and wait for client to send me selection. On a Wednesday, I'm on another shoot. Again, I'm on Thursday, I'm doing the same thing. Let's assume Monday shoot selection comes to me on Thursday. That means now I have to shoot on a Friday. I have to process Friday ka pictures on a Saturday. I also have to start touching up on the pictures on Thursday. So when you're working nonstop, you have no time for digital. Digital is the last resort. Even if you have retouchers now, good ones, and you send it to them, you still have to check it. You still have to do markings. You still have to do color correction. At the end of the day, it is your name, your work. So you have to have your input in it. So everything starts adding up as time, and time suddenly disappears because you're either shooting, you're either ideating, you're either marketing, you're either doing accounting, or you're spending time on Photoshop, which you could have avoided if you had planned it properly. And my career has been this only, that planning is super important to me. I have workflows. In fact, a few years back, I got the first prize for the most influential photographer. Yeah, you know, I mean, and I beat Canon and Epson and these companies because I have a workflow system in my studio, like a proper business house, where even how you are supposed to talk to a client is written down for someone who walks in. How you're supposed to greet your watchman is also written down. How you're supposed to, you know, input the photos, rename them, tag them, backup on them, put it in digital, go into the server, take double backups, make high-res backup, go on to a cloud backup, get a low-res cataloging done. So I have a whole, you know, Girish, I at one of my shoots, I lost one whole shot. It was a 14 shot campaign. And during the last shot, the girl had fever. She had 104 degrees fever. I'm doing the shot. I've done the shot. We take the backup. We come home. And that last shot has not been backed up. And the hard disk has crashed while coming from the studio to my office. It happened to me twice. I sat down and I did research for almost 3 months on how to do backups, what are the best, you know, equipment, how do I do backup on the shoot. So I carry now, you know, I tried hard disk. I tried, you can name the hard disk company from a Toshiba, Lassie, do, you know, you name the hard disk, your WD, which are the ones which actually survive. So what I would do is I would put a hard disk, leave it on 48 hours working on Photoshop, some action, see how hot it gets, see whether it's working, not crashing. I used to buy different hard disks and, you know, what do you say, start backing up. 6 months ke baad, take them out, put them and see, are they working? And invariably, a lot of them would crash. I finally developed a system where I realized, for me, Assemble didn't work. Dell machines worked. I got myself a super high Dell machine. I got myself an Alienware laptop. I got myself a Dell server tower. I standardized my workflow, like my backup, my sizing, my color correction, and my markings, how they're supposed to be done, what is supposed to be marked on a photo, what is supposed to be removed, what is supposed to be put, which hard disk to be used. Like I only now use only Seagate. Kuch bhi ho jaye, matlab nahi hai to main jaunga hi nahi shoot pe jaise. But on a shoot, I have 3 hard disks. So I'll have a dock with 2 Seagate 4TB hard disks. I'll have a Lassie ka, what do you say, SSD now. I come to the studio, we back up, and that's how we, you know, take it. It goes into my machine. It gets backed up at the same time into a server. Same time it goes through. I even did research on which software works. I spent $1,000 on buying the right software for my backup because I wanted an automated system. So from my machine, it goes to like 5 different machines and it's getting backed up in 5 different places. One for me, one for server, one for home, one for studio, portable, one low-res for my assistant to send to client, one high-res JPEG to keep as a backup safety because it's easier to keep JPEG on the cloud. So I really worked hard to make systems to run a studio automatically so that I don't waste time, because when you start working 15 days, trust me, all these things start piling up and adding up. Okay. And you can't, and kids today don't realize that. When you talk about Photoshop, I love Photoshop because I can use it, but I hate Photoshop because it's a painful, you know, or a wasteful use of time for things which you didn't plan, or things or lighting which could have been better. Like, you know, so if your lighting is perfect on the job, you don't have to use Photoshop because you did a great job. You just process it and you send it off and it works. You know, if your set was perfect and it was cleaned properly, you know, it goes off. There's a shoot I'll show you and I'll explain why it is important that, you know, you should not not rely so much on post and digital.
Which shoot is it?
There's a, it's a very basic garment shoot, which I had emailed, I had sent to
her. You're sharing or do we have it?
I've sent it to her. Do you have it? Shall I show it?
What's the name on it?
Video you are talking about.
No, photos, photos.
Photos, it's on my mobile. If you can share.
Okay, wait, I'll share from here. I'll explain to you the reason why. So this is in my, okay, I had what messaged you, right? It's in my, okay. 1 second, guys. I know where it is. Rid, I think from your side now the website is also opening faster, is it?
Yeah, so
can you just go onto my website, just go to the regular website.
Okay, I'll share.
Yeah, I'll stop sharing.
Which others so they can get others also ready? You want to show the Kingfisher campaign or which other stuff you want?
Yeah,
to
Kingfisher we can show as a exercise in how big a shoot can get. So no
gallery, you want to check it out?
No, just go to Vikram's, just the basic just click on my name. No, just click on the name also chalega. Showcase, go to showcase, the first gallery. Yeah. And if you can scroll down, keep scrolling, there will be an Indian shoot. So I'll start talking about this, okay? The shoot till it comes up. So I have this designer client. They're one of the top 5 or 10 designers in the country. And so what happens with them is that their collections are quite huge. When we started working, it was like, 6 campaign shots. Then it became 6 campaign shots and 6 catalog shots. It kept increasing their friends. So it kept increasing to a point where now I do 90 to 100 shots a day. And they're all campaign shots. Or they're all straightforward catalog. So there's a mix of, I would say 70% campaign shots.
And do you want to stop us?
No, yeah, I keep going down. Yeah.
Continue talking.
Yeah. So the thing is, yeah, this one, this true. If you can just go up. Yeah, you can't click on it. Just go up a little bit. You'll see. Yeah. Like even this one, the right one, it starts from here. Then you go down, so I've just put 4 or 5, the ones I like, these two. So if you see this is not like, generally model ko khada kiya or shoot kiya. Yeah, the last ones are like that. Just the typical catalog shots. The last two. But the first one, so what we do is we do a mix of creative, candid, plus hardcore standing, with a studio light or in a location, and every picture has a different location or a different angle or a different thing. So I am on location at a place shooting only 8 hours, depending on the light. We don't start at 7 in the morning because this was shot in Baroda. So we flew down to Baroda. We landed up at the place. The models are getting their makeup done. They come to me at 10 o'clock or 10:30. I wind up shoot at 5:36 because we have a flight to go back. And I have done 90 shots like this in one day. And I am saying without options, that is 90 garments, 90 compositions. The client has picked up maybe another 50 angles, little bit left, right, mood changes out of that. So technically 150 pictures have gone to a client, every picture looking different shot in one day. So I have no time to think when I'm shooting. I'm only framing, shooting, moving, framing, shooting, moving everyone. And I have to come back, process, touch up, clean, and give it to them within 48 hours. So if I had to, think iske upar Photoshop karunga, so I would be dead.
That is true. That is true.
So Photoshop is a tool. It's not the end all.
That's true. We're just putting the Kingfisher thing. Is there anything else you want to show?
Yeah, we can show the Kingfisher thing. I think you have the video, right?
I think so.
I'll show pictures.
Yeah. Okay. These are the pictures that you shot.
Yeah, these are the pictures. So this is like the first time anyone in India actually shot an airline campaign to this scale. I'm sure there were pictures before that of airlines because I had seen, but no one had a plane parked for them for 24 hours with the ACs on inside and permission from the airport to actually sit down and do the lighting the way we did it, because we wanted to make it look real. So basically I used what film people do, large scale lighting, all HMIs in those days. In fact, this is very low res because it's a little while back. So
that's an old one. Yeah.
This is how we started. We reached there again in the morning at 4 o'clock or something, 3:34. You know, the equipment took 4 hours to come in. This was the plane parked for us in the hangar. This was outside. Then we went into the hangar. That was my assistants doing time pass. So we had a crew of 120 people over there. A minimum crew of 120 people, including passengers, lighting team, production, makeup artists, food. And this is when the lighting started in the morning at around... See, you can see the sunrise coming up over there. That is around 6:30, So this is when we started doing the lighting. And it took us like a couple of hours, 2-3 hours. I had a big team. I had like around 50 people or 60 people just doing only lighting. This is the lighting setup that was happening.
Yeah, the size of the production is colossal.
Yeah, so the size of the production in today's money value would be approximately 2 CR. Wow. And in today's money value, I would make like maybe, or rather in those days, I made like 5% of the total production cost. That's what I made. So I really didn't end up making too much, but I just did it because of the experience and, just getting there and trying to do something new.
But it's interesting because a lot of people think a plane maker on camera goes up there, but they don't understand. There are nuances out there.
We have to balance the lighting because a plane has tungsten lighting, or rather LED tungsten. Everything mix. You've got green, you've got blue, you've got whatever color. So you
don't put your tripod also.
And there's no space to put a tripod. There are angles which I've taken. If you can show the pictures again, there's a horizontal image of the boy and girl sitting. We are shooting on a, and you don't want distortion. Remember, if I take too much of a wide angle, you're going to get distortion. You don't need distortion. So it can't be a, wide angle proper. So I wish I had a photo somewhere I have where I'm standing on top, this one, yeah. Where I'm standing on top of the chairs, actually at the back with the tripod balancing almost like a monopod with my Mamiya and shooting to get the right frame.
The campaigns you'd like to show?
Sorry?
Any other campaign you want to show?
Well, there are quite a few, Girish.
We'll put it up. We have that. You already sent it to us.
Yeah, just one second. I'll just see.
You want something on architecture? You want something on...
Yes, you can show the architecture, the Amanora shoot. You can show the... So that was very interesting. Today we do drone and stuff like that. I still don't prefer a drone because you need to have large size pictures sometime for large size campaigns. Okay, unless you're using one of those Phantom with a Hasselblad lens and stuff like that, where you have a high resolution. So there's a campaign I did where they had just bought the highest crane in the world, a fire brigade crane, which goes up to 175 feet. So I actually went up there and like a fool, I tied my camera. Okay, if anything falls down, camera will be safe. Not realizing that nothing is safe. So this is like on a Hasselblad. And they needed really high-end, high resolution images. So I'm shooting on a 100 megapixel back.
Wow.
Yeah, so I'm shooting on a 100 megapixel back and we are going up to that height. And every few minutes, they would start screaming on a walkie-talkie, come down, wind is increasing. So when the wind increases, you have the possibility of falling down. So I kept going up and down for almost 1 hour, on this crane, on that thing, shooting. I've done that 2 days in a row. And the first day I didn't feel anything. It was exciting because it was something new and I've always done these type of things. I've actually done a campaign hanging out of a helicopter with my assistant only holding onto my belt, not realizing the belt could have come up. So when I did this also, I was pretty happy and excited to do something new. It was the second day when I did the shoot. If you show the photos, there's actually a storm coming on the other side. And the wind was so high that it took an effort for us to come down that fast. Otherwise, we may just have toppled. And that's when I realized it's scary. I told the client, next time I do this, I want more money and I want insurance taken out. You can go to Gal. Yeah. So, you know, like I said, I started out as a landscape photographer. Not many people know that when I started out, Sara Ambivali was coming up. And for 3 years, 15 days a month, I was parked in Sara Ambivali shooting their projects. And since I was a landscape guy, they'd seen my landscape. They loved my landscape, the way I framed my images. So they called me to do that. And for 3 years, I did Sara Ambivali. So today also, some clients who are aware of me, they call me to do these campaigns. So this image down there on the left side is the image I took from the crane. All these images also, but the wide angle, if you notice, that shot from a crane.
Yes, quite. Yeah,
yeah, because there was nothing around it. It's like an empty space. If you see, this is the garden. So, you know, the whole place is empty. So there's no place to actually go up on a building or something to shoot. Even if, so this is the, if you go, if you open this picture, not the color picture, the night shot.
This.
Yeah. Now, you know, like you saw the Kingfisher one, I like doing large sets. So this picture, I wish we could zoom in. Every room is lit by me. Every room. No, that's the limit you have for there. Yeah. So every room is lit by me. The stairs in front are lit by me. You know, the dome has naturally done lighting by the architects. That was the only thing that was there. The blue light on the umbrellas was there. Every other light you see in the picture is by me. So I had like 4 truckloads of equipment coming from Bombay to Pune. And I always do these architecture shots. I reach the site mostly at 11:30, 12. I tell my lighting guys, kya karna hai, kaise karna hai. They sit down and they start lighting. 2:33 is when lighting should be finalized. I start taking my test shots, and 4:30, quarter to 5 is when I start shooting, and I keep, you know, variating my exposure up, down, and keep seeing what looks good. And the last 15 minutes, you know how the sun suddenly comes up. So this is shot, I think, around 5:30, just before the sun has come up. In fact, there's a very good picture. I'll talk about this picture again. Any of these properties that I shot, including the one from the crane, has no windows. If you saw that video, you can see there's no windows. It's still under construction. So all the properties are first lit by me, like especially the night shots. Then after that, I go back and I get them cleaned so it looks like it's actually a ready space to move in. That's something that I am good at. There should be one more picture of this series, which is really nice. We can go up also. It's okay. Any pictures. Yeah. So if these two pictures that you see, the building and the, what do you say, other stuff. So even the building is lit by me. If you notice, there are some windows. So I have actually on top the light, which is at the blue, pink, blue. Those are also my tungsten lighting. It's all tungsten lighting. There's no flash in any of lighting. Every flat has, you know, what do you say, tungsten bouncing on the ceilings to spread out and stuff like that. Everywhere it is like that. The picture on the right side also, if you see, if you click on that, the blue one, this one, see, this is what happened. I got lucky with the sky. So I keep experimenting and I keep waiting for the right light, and we just got lucky with the sky. But if you see the light in the blue area at the back, behind the bridge, the small little lights, even that is by me. Because I need it. And even the trees are lit up. If you notice, every tree has a light. So we've got light everywhere. So like every shot has like a couple of hundred small, big tungsten lights. There's no HMIs. They're all babies. I mean, not babies also, just small tungsten bulbs or tungsten halogens being bounced in different places. And then my boys have to go and, you know, use ND filters to match every tungsten light ka reading, because they go from one corner of the tree to the other corner with their meter, and they're measuring the light, and I'm telling them, nahin, come jada on the walkie-talkie, come jada, jada, come whatever. And they're balancing it on the tree, in the garden, on the spotlights, till we, you know, get it right. And there is no post, guys. I can actually share the raw files to show that there is no post.
I'll try to show one of the pictures in the fashion category. You shot all those celebrities.
Yeah.
You know, let's see how you can explain how you did that kind of show. Do you have any movie on that?
No,
I didn't send the movie. I think it's there on my YouTube maybe. So there's quite a few videos on my YouTube. We've not actually promoted it, Abhita, because I don't have anybody and I don't have the time to sit down and promote it. But if you just go Vikram Bhava Films, so you'll find it, like, you know. So quite a few. And there'll be a few we'll try and start putting up faster now. Yeah, there it is. The one on top is the first one, the black and white sepia tone.
Yeah, that's how you started the whole ball game.
Yeah, this was in 2001. This was the first gatefold cover of the country. You know, double gatefold, if you want to call it. So, you know, this magazine had seen my experimenting and my infrared photography and my small books I used to take out as a portfolio. They called me and they said, like, we want to work with you. And I was a fashion photographer. I'd never shot a film star. I mean, I had shot Anupam Kher and Manisha Koirala for ad campaigns, but never a film star or a film magazine photography. So, but they liked my work. They said, we want to change the way photography is done for stars and stuff like that. You know, if you remember, it was all soft focus, you know, it was all filtered with filters on their faces. So, you know, portraits in those days, you know, so they didn't have any fashion element, touch, concept, styling, nothing. So Manish had just started getting famous, Manish Malhotra. So I suggested to them, okay, why don't we get the whole industry together from the people who are always going to be superstars and from the younger lot. So you can see in the end, Vivek Oberoi, who's still so young, you know, Sushmita and Bipasha had just started out. Saif had just done one movie or two movies. And the lot in the middle, you can see Akshay, Preeti, you know, Ritik had braces in those days when I did this shoot. So it was very surreal. They asked me to do this. There was no digital. It's when there was only film. Digital was still 4-5 years away. And I went to the Marriott, identified a place where we could have a set. We sort of got a set ready, but it was not a big set like this, but it was there. And we experimented with film. Like, I would take my assistants, make them sit in different places, different poses, come back, process the film, cut the pictures, put it together, make dummy covers to show to the magazine. The magazine would say, okay, yes, no, this works, this doesn't work. In the end, everybody got confused. I was doing that for 30 days, just seeing who'll sit where. We realized we don't know who's going to come on the final day. So we stopped experimenting. But, you know, one fine day we got these people, all these actors and actresses. And when they came in front of me, somehow it just fell in place. And over the years, I realized that the larger the set, the easier it is for me to shoot. Because my mind sort of is very easy putting things together. Like, this is actually a set Girish made in 2.5 hours. The whole set, starting, shooting, finishing is 4 hours. Because we had the space in the Oberoi's only for 4 hours. There was no option. So I went around with my stylist sourcing all these, you know, props and all, thinking of how it will be. You know, also another thing is photographers don't maybe realize, but teams are very important. You have to have the best teams. You know, even my work goes up and down because of the team I work with. There'll be times when, for me, this is a great set because the person I work with, even though I was there sourcing the products, you know, that person put this setup in 2 hours. I mean, stitching the background, putting it together, putting the stuff together in 2 hours. I would not have been able to do it. I mean, it's not my job in a way, not my forte, because I was never needed to do that. Yes, I tweaked it around once it was all put together. And when people came in front of me, I just knew where to put who, because of course we have a brief. So the first part is the cover, the middle will go inside, the last will go more inside. So I knew who will be on the first part and I knew who will be on the second part and the third part. How to place them, how to make them sit, how to stand somehow comes naturally to me now. Maybe because I've shot, like I said, my first year was only experimenting and only, understanding how to make people pose, how to do the lighting, what light works on them, what doesn't work on what type of faces. I mean, your apple or ball, I took it and I made, you know, different heads. I actually shot different heads. I had a bald friend, I had a semi-bald friend, I had a girl, I had a proper model, and I would always, you know, shoot them 360 lighting and understand how to make them look good. So now these things are natural.
But they all came together, or you did them separately?
They all came together.
Wow. Okay.
The later shoots, these colorful ones, some of them come together. Like there'll be some parts where they're together sometimes, and sometimes when they're not together. Like if you go down, like this yellow one, they are not together. And the biggest challenge is sometimes to convince them to pose in the way you want them to. Because these are stars. You have to understand a lot of them don't want to pose the way you say. They have their angles. They want to stand in a particular way. They want to sit in their own place. So I have to convince them, you know, okay, this is not how I want you, or this is how I want you. For example, this particular picture, one gentleman didn't want the bottles at the back, the alcohol bottles. But the alcohol bottle company is the sponsor. So how can you not be in a picture where there's no alcohol bottle? So I had to suddenly now decide to change his position. If I change his position, 5 other people may have to change. So I'm doing this on the fly, like, you know, and I'm keeping in mind the end result. I'm always keeping in mind how I want the image to come out. So that is how I start my shoot. And if things are going great, I know it's going to come out like this. If things are not going great, I know I need to make it work out so that my last end, when I go back on my computer, I don't want to get confused. I want the picture still looking the way I had thought about it, or, you know, like I had planned it.
I think we are running short of time. So what the last question that I want to ask you is that, is there anything that you would like to tell the newcomers, because they need to understand the hard work you put in?
Yeah.
And any advice you would like to give them? You know, maybe this Photoshop, and YouTube, but this is the real learning on the job.
Yeah,
guys, hard to put it in the room. Would like to know how long.
Yeah, so let me start. You know, I'll put it down in steps. First of all, there is no excuse not to learn. You are given a gift of a school, an opportunity to study at. I was not. I especially went to understand, you know, after being a professional, whether I am good enough or not. Okay. So if you have the opportunity, grab it, use it. That's the biggest thing I will tell you, that you need to learn. You need to practice. You need to study as many ideas, concepts, lighting, styles of different photographers, different teachers, to understand how you will be or what you can do, because there will be situations where suddenly, you know, client will say, I don't want this shot, I want a top shot. And you may not know how to do it, or you don't know what to do with the lighting. You know, they'll say, we want the model looking up and your camera has to be up there, and you don't have the equipment to do that suddenly, but you have to innovate and you need to do it. So first of all, get your education sorted, really. Next, I will say is practice, 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 experiment, experiment, experiment. Be open to 10,000 ideas from 10,000 people, whether it's a photographer, a friend, an artist, a painter, a sculptor. TV, movies is the biggest, you know, learning space for you. Also, like, you know, ideation. Then you need to plan your life career-wise. You need to plan your working style, your working habits are very important. You need to understand what goes into a shoot, right from ideation to, you know, styling requirement, makeup requirement, set requirement, casting. When I mean casting, it's model, it's the stylist, it's the makeup artist, it's the set director, art director, how many production person you're going to work with. Trust me, you don't want a Mr. Bachchan coming on the set and you're not having, you know, the right type of chair for him to sit on, or the right music for him to enjoy. You cannot put, you know, a Lady Gaga for a Mr. Bachchan. That is also planning. That is also planning. So your shoots have to, you have to learn to start planning your shoots. You have to learn to start planning your studios or your offices or your marketing plan. It's very important to have a marketing plan. Write down who you want to target. What are the type of people you want to work with? Don't just jump and go and say, yes, I want to work. You know, kuch bhi kaam milega. Nahin, that's not going to get you good work. Target what you want. Target who you want to work with. You know, and okay, let's assume you are a real estate or an architectural student. You love architecture. So who are you going to go work with? Target those people. You can't go to a film fair and say, I am very good at architecture. It doesn't work. I know, of course, you will know better than that. I mean, you're not going to make that silly mistake. It's not the right, example I'm giving you. But I'm just saying, go hire the right people. Make your marketing plan. Make a workflow for your processes from shooting, capturing, archiving. Trust me, a client will call you after 1 month and say, ye photo hai, and you'll be like, oh, maine delete kar diya. In fact, you could have told him, haan hai, but I'll charge you 10,000 rupees extra. Mujhe archive se nikalna padega. Do that. You know, so you need to have an archiving system, a backup system. You need to have a long-term plan for that, because digital is not as safe as film. Film rolls I still have lying from like 30 years when I started as a hobbyist, and they're still the way they were, perfect. I can still scan it today and give out if it's a 120 mm medium format roll, I can take out a 600 MB file even today. But with digital, trust me, you'll pick up a hard disk or you'll pick up a DVD or whatever and it's gone. You'll be like, 6 saal ke baad ye kya ho gaya? You know, so have a proper plan for that. Have a billing plan. How you want to bill your client, how you want to approach your client, how you want to, make them appreciate the rates you're charging, you know, what the different rates are for. Don't try and give away things for free thinking client mujhe kaam de dega aur aayega. Wo client wapas nahi aayega. Free mein jo bhi milta hai, free mein wo aadmi kha jata hai. He doesn't value you. So put a value for yourself, first of all. Work with the people who value you for your work and who pay you because they respect you, and that is what you should be getting. So your copyright, your usage, your model releases, your paperwork, because trust me, 2 saal, 4 saal. Today I got a message from someone I had shot 10 years back about a picture, and I had to put my foot down and say, sorry, when we worked and these were the rules and this was my billing. Because I have my first bill from 96, 97 sitting with me. I have copies of that. I have model releases of that. You have to have your paperwork sorted, with clients, for yourself, your accountant, with the government. Simple things like software. You have cracked software. Great. Use it till you can. Jis din pakde jaoge, they'll come and they'll catch you. And they do that. Photoshop will actually come to your office and have a raid because you're doing well in life or you're a photographer. So, or they'll call you, okay, are you using this software? We got a ping from your IP address in your computer. It's happened to us. It's just, I'm lucky that I realized this 10 years back and I only take official software from everywhere. Or I don't take only. I refuse. Nowadays, I've started using my phone for editing on the fly. If it's not, because I know that when I'm shooting, that my pictures have to be so good that I don't want to jump into Photoshop. So if I'm perfect, I just have to process it and send it off. Khatam. Why waste my energy? So plan. Every step has to have a workflow, a plan, a system, and life will become easier. When you start growing higher, it'll be easier for you to, do your work at a good speed.
There's a question from somebody who said, would like to know, how can we plan shoots in this kind of COVID-19 situation?
Well, physical shoots at the moment is not easy. If you have people who are ready to work with you, I have done a shoot recently, an outdoor shoot, because the team was ready to work. But safety comes first. I have done that and I don't feel I want to do that again. Iske baad mein a shoot like that. I don't mind doing it if I'm not interacting with the person. Like I was telling Girish, I'll shoot with a Zoom lens. I don't have to meet the person. We can talk, ideate, have a conversation on Zoom or whatever. And then, do that. planning is something you can do at home. Physical shooting is difficult. You need to get permissions, if I'm not mistaken. If you are doing a big shoot, if you're doing a small shoot, you don't need permissions, but you have to be very careful because the cops are not going to be very happy, and depends on where you do it. So I think just plan your ideas, plan the execution, and when it opens up, do that. If you are lucky and you have a model at home, like a muse at home, and you can always then, you know, start doing that. Otherwise, you have your online shoots, which I'm not a fan of.
Thank you so much, Vikram. I think there's a lot of stuff that you've shared today to the members here who attended. And yes, we will be putting up this. We have recorded this video, so we're going to be putting it out on IGTV and YouTube. So hopefully, lots of people will get an insight of how difficult and how tough and how hard you worked to reach where you are. So from my side, it's big congratulations that you reached where you made us feel that the effort that we've been putting all these years is worth it. You know, it's basically what happens is we keep on churning out students, but when we see our students do terrific work is when we feel that there's a job satisfaction here, where we feel that, okay, this was worth the effort that we're. In your case, it was very small little thing, but Babre, you were gone.
No, it opened my eyes, Girish. Your first day of the lecture showed me what I was doing, but I could see suddenly. I actually still say it. I saw light. And from that day, I can see light, the way it falls, where it falls, how it falls. I mean, a lot of people use tungsten or whatever. I use flash also. I can see the shadows. So thank you for that, Girish.
Thank you so much. And before we close, see you all on every Wednesday and Saturday evening, 6 p.m. onwards on Zoom with registration, please, because so that we know who is sitting with us, so that we can interact with you. And yes, this was the start, and we are going to bring in a lot of students. And it's not always that we're going to bring our superstars only. We are going to bring in some of our strugglers also. So that we need to balance it. We need to make people understand that a bed of roses nahi hai. This is something that you have to really, really struggle for. But at the same time, the strugglers, if you see the effort they're putting, if you see the results they're churning out, and you feel so good. You feel so good that when they came to us, they were raw. Camera pakadne ko nahi aata tha. And the effort they put in. So it is. Going to be fun. I think I'm sure that we'll be doing more of these shows, and we'll look forward to seeing you again and again. Yeah, so this Saturday we'll see you at 6 o'clock with Amruta. So thanks a lot, Vikram. Thanks a lot. Love to Humring and family. Daddy ko to pehle bahut hi har din hamare taraf se.
Yeah, all the best to everyone who's been here watching, and take care. See you.
Bye. Stay safe, stay secure, stay healthy, guys.